even if we took out pharma, my sense is that, and I think the CHIA reports back this up, Ray will tell me if I'm wrong, that your costs are not actually falling, that they're basically rising roughly in line with the other provider costs. So maybe I'm wrong, and I'd be happy to know that, but should we have expected more in the way of actual cost reductions from integrated systems? And if, why have we not seen more?
So we've actually, at the request of the Health Policy Commission, looked contract by contract with respect to where our rates of rise have been. What we have found in our large contracts is that, not surprisingly, pharma expenses have gone up about 30%, but hospital and doctor prices have been, and total medical expense have gone up 1 to 2%, so below the cost trend. I believe it was a CHIA document that showed that membership in the Bay State system was actually not predictive of higher costs. We've grown by accretion of a number of struggling hospitals that were having difficulties breaking even, and adding community hospital capacity is allowing us to do more and more in a lower cost venues. It's still a work in progress. We believe that, you know, another 10 or 20% of the inpatient care we give could be done away from our big teaching hospital and in the smaller community hospitals. And to that end, we're deploying specialists out to those hospitals on a regular basis. So I think there is more that can be done, but as of right now, our cost trends are below the benchmark as far as doctors and hospitals.
I just want to fix one fact before turning it over to Dr. Strongwater. My sense is that 1% to 2% is the same as the Commonwealth outside of pharma. So that is, you're hitting roughly the average of the Commonwealth. That's what I meant by the statement. I apologize for saying the benchmark. So that we haven't seen superior performance on costs relative to the rest of the Commonwealth.
I think in terms of redesigning healthcare costs, there is something to be said for the Porter argument as well. We actually have seen cost reduction in a number of the areas where we've done bundled payment initiatives. So a drop in 10% in our cost for total joint replacement, similar trends in CABG. So I think as you work disease by disease, you are able to see cost reductions. And remember that it's not just pharma that adds to, I mean, there are a number of devices and extensions of indications for a variety of therapies, which tend to increase the overall cost. So I'm not sure that we're ever going to see a diminishment in the cost curve so much as the bending of the cost curve that folks have talked about.
But you're still not beating the rest of the Commonwealth.
I'm sorry?
You're still not beating the rest of the Commonwealth. Again, I want to press this point because the hope, I mean, Dr. Berenson brought this up, the hope was that by integrating, we would manage to somehow lower spending. And I think the fact is that we haven't, that basically the big integrated providers are increasing in cost just as rapidly as the non-integrated providers.
But we're trailing the, we're still the low cost system in the state and are, you know, well behind the network averages of nearly every commercial managed care payer.
Now, I do think it's the right question, and I would want to just emphasize there is a difference between price and total medical expense, and our focus has been on total medical expense. I think for the public payers, Medicaid and Medicare, federal costs, look at Pioneer as an example, are the lowest in the region and we've consistently done well, and more recently, at least over the past 3 or 4 years in the Medicaid space, have consistently kept costs below the network. And of late, at least one large commercial contract, our costs have come down. Now, I would argue that part of the reason that we've not been able to do more is the environment in which we are working. That is, we are seeing increases in hospital expenses. We do think there are some regulatory opportunities, particularly around our ability to run our own ambulatory surgery center, that would help us to further reduce costs. And I believe over time that we should be able to drive down total medical expense in this market.
I apologize for monopolizing. Can I just follow up? How many years should it be before we look at the two organizations, before we see material differences in trend between your organizations organizations in Massachusetts.
I would say if you look right now, you'd find material differences. Our total expense for a Medicare patient, we're one of the few next generation ACOs. The cost per year per recipient is about $8,500 compared to someplace north of $10,000. And so you're already seeing low-cost care at high quality if you look today. Not to say that more couldn't be done. We face considerable headwinds with respect to a fee-for-service reimbursement mechanism, for particularly for specialty care. So I think more costs could come out, but you wouldn't, I mean, a detailed examination would reveal that we're already leading in terms of affordability.
Can I just let Dr. Starwater respond?
And I'd say it's a very complicated question, even though it sounds pretty straightforward, which has to do with the other moving parts in a healthcare environment. What happens to hospital costs? What happens to pharma costs? I think that if we had more data transparency, which would allow us to work more aggressively in the behavioral health space and capture more aggressively the social determinants, so we could intervene and build programs, I think I could give you a better answer. But otherwise, I don't think I could give you a number of years kind of answer.
Mary Luke.
So I just want to move this a little, variation on a theme. So first of all, thank you all for being here. So since this is a cost trends hearing, and I very much appreciate the comments on pharma. Closer to home, Massachusetts has one of the highest rates of readmissions. And by most experts, they would say that preventable readmissions is considered a driver of our medical costs. And since we have a great representation here of systems, hospitals, insurers, I would actually ask if all of you, just going down the line, what have you or are planning to do that's within your role to bring down the readmission rates, preventable readmission rates?
Secretary Sutters, we completely agree with you. We think readmission rates should be
I don't consider myself an expert on this one.
But we think, based on work in other states, that we can be in the single digits in this region, and you know we're at 15 to 20%. What we've done is we've worked collaboratively with individual hospital partners. We would love to make it a requirement that our care and case managers be placed in every ED or be allowed to work in every ED. That doesn't always happen, which would allow us to activate our VNA care services for preventable readmissions. We believe that more people on monitored services, particularly those at high risk for readmission, to our VNA would make a significant impact on readmission rates. And having what we would consider to be warmer handoffs would likewise help to reduce.
At Bay State, we've been part of the STAR Collaborative from the very beginning. About 30 of our primary care sites are certified at the highest level as patient-centered medical homes, and therefore have embedded care managers who coordinate readmissions. About half of them also have embedded behavioral health providers to help with the social determinants of health and the psychiatric comorbidities, which often lead to readmissions. As a result of this and a lot of additional activity, including admission avoidance activities within the emergency room itself, the Bay State Medical Center was one of the few teaching hospitals not penalized in the recent federal round. And I believe only one of our community hospitals received any kind of a penalty, and it was one which had a geriatric psychiatry unit where readmission rates are high and an area we're working on.
It's a great question, Secretary, and it is one of those few kind of big dot measures that we can look at as a state and work on. And it's also one of those measures where we know that improving the measure will simultaneously lower costs and improve care. What we've been trying to do is provide even better information to our hospital and physician partners about our members when they're hospitalized to help with that transition. And we already have in place, to the extent that we have these alternative payment models, the financial and quality incentives are already there for the practices and the hospitals to act, as you just heard of. So I think we have the incentives are in place. We know the number is higher than it should be, and we ought to have a focused statewide effort to reduce it.
Because it really hasn't come down. I mean, we've talked about this for another. Yes. Your
Right, the queen of why do we have such high readmission rates? What would be helpful to me, I think to all of us, is to hear what you think still needs to be done in order to bring this down. Because we've essentially been at the same rate for the 4 years that we've been having these hearings. And not, I know Dr. Torchiana disagrees with me, but not much has changed. What has to change in order to bring this down? Excuse me, so that we're not sitting here next year being 43rd worst in the country. I mean, I know you're doing interesting things. Why can you not have these people in the emergency rooms? Why can we not do better than this?
I mean, I'll defer to, and obviously my physician and hospital colleagues are closer to this than me. I think our system is still very hospital-centered. Our healthcare system nationally, and especially our healthcare system in Massachusetts. And part of the way to avoid readmissions is to focus services and communication and support in the home post-admission. I think that's an area where we just need to build more support and more services for patients post-discharge.
Exactly what I was going to say is, you know, our plan strategy, and we can't obviously, since we're a new organization, we can't measure any improvement at this time, but and also picking up on another thing that Andrew said is the way that we are thinking about all of the way that we build this company and deploy care is wherever possible, do not try to over-medicalize everything all of the time. And start thinking about the context in which people get sick and the context in which somebody is admitted. Now, obviously, when somebody is admitted and you don't want them to be readmitted, there is a medicalized aspect of this, and we don't ignore that. So yes, getting the right people in the home immediately following the discharge is one of the strategies. In addition to having skilled human beings in the home, some of them clinicians, some of them non-clinicians, we are also thinking about ways to use telemedicine. For example, we are speaking with an organization called Maven Project, which works to connect retired or semi-retired, licensed, insured, board-certified specialists with communities that historically have had more trouble accessing specialist care. We're speaking with them about collaborating on a number of initiatives, but one, for example, would be how do you, through HIPAA-compliant telemedicine, bring psychiatry into the home following an inpatient discharge for a behavioral health admission is one example.
Yeah, I agree. In fact, I was just meeting with a psychiatrist at Mass General, Dr. Wozniak, and she reinforced for me the value of telemedicine to connect with her patients who are young adolescents that can exhibit not only a more realistic view of what the patient is like rather than schlepping them in and trying to find parking and getting up to the exam room. It's a very different world, but can actually see the patient with his or her parent in the home and can see the home and can see if there's some risks there. So I do believe telemedicine is a valuable solution for going forward. The other area that we're running into still, and we'll get past this, but in this kind of transformation to prepaid global, carriers negotiate with the leadership of the clinical care system well, and we understand the details of this deal, but what's not adequately happening yet is the specifics and the dynamics are not being adequately, and we take responsibility for this, as all of us need to. It's not getting out to the clinicians who are right there, you know, on the front lines, and you know, they don't understand what they're doing, why they're doing it, how it relates to this complex global arrangement. So just because we're globally capitating a wonderful care delivery system, we still have a lot of work to do to help our clinicians and their supporting staff understand how it can work better.
Well, yeah, I just would echo the comments about telemedicine, and I think in particular regulations that, I don't know if we call them regulations, but policies that pay physicians, for instance, in our Atrius Health practice to, rather than national players, allow us to more rapidly deploy telemedicine, I think would help. And I want to comment on and compliment the work of DPH in approving the regs, deploying the regs for mobile integrated health for the use of paramedics, which would allow the deployment of paramedics to people's homes in advance of them having to return to the emergency room. Once you return to an emergency room, the risk of being admitted goes up significantly. So the use of those paramedicine staff, I think, will make a difference in addition to comments.
I'd just like to sharpen the point that Eric made as well. We've added a number of patches in terms of dealing with globally budgeted arrangements. So we've added care managers. We've added physicians in the emergency room to avoid admission. But the thing we're patching looks an awful lot like the system that I practiced in 30 years ago. I've heard primary care doctors tell me that they still feel that they're on a hamster wheel in terms of RVU reimbursement. So the sooner that we can uncouple a globally budgeted system from fee-for-service at the ground level, the quicker I think we're going to make real progress in thoughtful system design.
This is a very important area. So we need to get back to it at some point, but I want to make sure everyone gets there.
Yeah, so on a different take, I have a question I think that for Andrew and Eric, as insurers. You know, 5 or 6 years ago, we thought that offering different insurance products, and I'm thinking of the limited or tiered network products, were a way to get consumers more engaged and hopefully direct them to the right care at the right settings. You know, we know that the narrow network products really never took off here, and the adoption of limited network products, you know, grew somewhat, but really has flattened. And I hear from the members of AIM that they think, A, the copay differentials aren't really enough to influence many consumers' decisions, and the premium differentials for the employers of those other products isn't enough for them to begin limiting choice. So I guess I would just like you to comment on those observations. And do you have any thoughts about product design that could address this and achieve the goals that we were hoping 5 or 6 years ago?
Sure. Thanks, Rick. I think one question we should ask ourselves is, what did we think it would be? And I think we all went into this transitioning into narrow networks and tiered networks, each of us individually, with our own personal expectation of what defines success. And I do believe that based on all of the individuals with whom I've spoken with over the years, I think the expectations, frankly, were too great, or the expectations of where we would end up. So a couple of points here. One, I initiated a narrow network in Central Mass years ago when I was at Ballin Community Health Plan. I certainly can't speak for them now, but it was highly successful in a couple of ways. One, it was only sold to employers alongside a broad network-based product, because we learned from the 90s that you don't want to offer your employees the cheap plan, one that's based on a narrow network. If you offer choice to your employees alongside a defined dollar contribution, and then you pay up for the difference, it's a very responsible, in my view, nice, clear, relatively easy way to start engaging consumers on the cost of their choices. In Central Mass, we saw a dramatic uptick in the purchase of the narrow network. Equally important was that it also allowed Fallon at the time to be offered to a number of employers that wanted it when the other carriers weren't. The other piece is there was about a 3 to 4 year uptick from a starting point 4 years down the road where they would end up about 50-55% of the employee population offering it. It was predominantly valuable in the small employer market. So you don't see the impact of big numbers because these are lots of small employers. The other area, and certainly this is the one I experienced when I went out with a statewide narrow network called Focus at Harvard-Pilgrim, is I had a number of hospital executives calling me saying, how can I get into your network? That was with the narrow network. And then I had others calling me saying, how can I get into your tier one from tier two? So we shouldn't underestimate the value of it opening up the negotiation doors. That's not always reflected in the numbers. So I'm a believer in it. It's one tool in the tool chest. It's not the be all.
Rick, I share some of Eric's optimism. Our tiered product continues to be very popular among our small employers. We have a 90% renewal rate for our tiered product, so they're clearly happy in it. There are differentials, so, you know, we could argue whether they're high enough. And we have different kinds of tiered products, some that tier just hospitals and some that tier hospitals and primary care physicians. I am enthusiastic. We're going to be offering, beginning in 2017, a narrow network for the first time in a number of years. And we've worked hard to try to align that network with the results from our alternative quality contract payment model. So we're putting high value hospitals and physicians in that select network, and it is going to be a closed network. So we'll see. So we're really trying to try different things. And so I caution you, don't give up. We may not have seen the results that you hope for initially, but we're making progress.
Rick, can I add on one piece I didn't respond to, and that is the differential. The differentials are not enough to cause consumers to make a different choice for hospitalization right now. We've worked with our friends over at Harvard University who's been doing some research on it. Frankly, there's very little research out there in the United States that we can point to that shows. But I believe that we should try to create products that have a significant differentiation in hospitalization co-payments, if you will. But at the same time, we should lower what the consumer is required to pay if she or he picks one in tier one. So let's not just make it a stick, but let's offer a reward. Because in our data analysis, and we've laid this out to some of our customers to look at, there is some real savings opportunity.
I would just add, there will be some more analysis coming out soon. So the research team at Harvard Medical School, led by Mike Chernew, has done an analysis of our tiered products and their effect on use and utilization and price. And I think there will be some promising results published soon on that topic to share with
you. Let's move on, Ron, and then we'll just keep, I'll keep going back and forth as long as my neck holds up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was recently talking to a CEO of a large hospital system outside of Massachusetts, and one of the items on the agenda happened to be prescription drugs. And Eric highlighted that earlier, and his response actually surprised me. He agreed. It's an issue. He said, you shouldn't stop there. He said, you need to look at medical devices. Do you know we're paying more for some medical devices that we're implanting than the entire procedure costs? He says, we have firms that get something approved, and as soon as it gets approved, you have a tenfold increase in price. Now, I had never heard that before, and I was just wondering if you folks have seen that and whether you agree with that issue.
We certainly are seeing increases in device costs and price levels of devices that are astounding. And, you know, part of it is the advance of technology, but part of it is simply taking advantage of physician preferences and some very active sales activity on the part of the representatives. So we've had a very active value analysis program run by physicians trying to get down to either a single choice for any given type of medical device, whether it be a pacemaker, implantable joint, or whatever, or a single reference price to which all others would then come down. We've used our national GPO in this regard, but there's no substitute for getting the doctors themselves involved in understanding what things cost, that is to say the specialists. The bundled care initiatives help a lot in this regard as well.
Yeah. I have a question for Eric and Andrew's slightly different tack. Eric spoke about transparency, we're all in favor of it. Among the worst news this year to me in health policy world was the Gobain decision, in which Vermont was precluded from mandating participation in the all-payer claims database, I think on ERISA preemption grounds. I'm not sure what the logic is. So commercial insurers followed suit, voluntarily withdrawing from all-payer claims databases, even though Gobain doesn't preclude voluntary participation. I think that's a threat. I'll say with Sharon Sanchez here, I'm also worried about the declining funding for CHEO. This state's got to maintain commitment, a full commitment to transparency. So my question is, can we count on commercial insurers in the state, Blue Cross and Harvard Pilgrim for starters, to participate in the All Payer Claims database? And if there's problems with that, what can we do to make it become the standard? We need everybody in this game.
John, you hit the nail on the head, and we're equally concerned with it. And we've always been a stalwart supporter of transparency. And Bob Berenson said it very well, and I'm glad he brought it up. It must be about transparency of cost and quality, because consumers still are believing that if the cost is higher, the quality must be higher. And we do run the issue of being out ahead with costs and inadequate comparative quality measures that are useful for consumers of seeing increases in costs that we wouldn't otherwise see. But I say get it out there and let's keep moving forward. But you certainly have Harvard Pilgrim support in an all-payer database. In fact, I believe that databases should be run by other than health insurers. We should access something that's being created by a public-private partnership, and we use it consistently.
It's an important point, Don, and we also, Blue Cross is committed to transparency and working with the state in these efforts. I would note there's a growing national opinion that the Beauvais decision impacts all ERISA plans, not even just self-insured plans. So given that uncertainty, we're looking forward to working with the leadership of CHIA to understand what actions are being taken nationally and what options Massachusetts should consider. We're looking also for guidance from the Department of Labor. With that said, I want to highlight that Blue Cross, and I'm sure the other plans, submitted all requested data to the HQC and CHIA on TME, on relative price, on alternative payment methodologies, on premium data. And so there's a lot of market monitoring that can occur with these data sources, even without the use of the ABC data. So we hope the state continues that effort. There's probably, I'm not sure there's a state in the country that collects more data information from plans and hospitals than this state. And I would urge that this might be a moment to kind of rationalize a little bit how best to collect the data, how to do it in a streamlined way, in a way that gives us the kind of insights that you're looking for. So we support transparency, we support all payer claims databases, but as the named plan in this particular case, we also have to be careful. We, you know, our legal counsel have consulted with legal counsel both in the state, federal agencies, and the other parties. So
is there anything we could do that would make it easier for you to be 100% in instead of slicing it?
Well, I mean, I don't think you can, I guess you would almost need to have a federal law passed, I think, given the Supreme Court ruling. I think getting some further guidance from the Department of Labor, which oversees the regulation of the ERISA plans, might be a good thing, and it might be for the state to do that. But I also think, John, doing some analysis about what we're getting today, what is it that we're potentially missing, and are there alternative ways to get at that? Maybe. So I don't know that analysis has been done yet. It's probably very helpful for the HPC and CHIA to collaborate with us on such an analysis.
Thanks. I want to go back to sort of another cost driver. The Health Policy Commission and the Attorney General's Office have reported extensively on behavioral health as a cost driver, particularly in emergency room utilization. Chairman Sanchez spoke this morning about ER boarding. We have long waits for outpatient care. Low reimbursement rates are leading to the closure of some clinics, as well as a lot of practitioners opting out of being part of insurance panels. We talk about telemedicine as a possible solution, but it's feeling to me like these issues aren't going away, and I'm curious for the panel what strategies you're looking at to address some of the issues of behavioral health as a continuing cost driver.
So in some rough estimates that we developed off of preliminary data organization was given, it looked like that when we stratified the top 5% of the high, so-called sort of high cost, high need, that approximately 80% of those individuals had either a mental health or substance use disorder diagnosis. So I couldn't agree more. Addressing that in our model of care will be embedded in everything that we do. So starting within the exam room to have fully integrated teams, regardless of what the patient is presenting for, at the point of care that there are clinicians available to come into the exam room during that. Also different strategies in follow-up care, so not even necessarily making a hard line in the SANS designation for the individual around that they're coming back in for physical health or that they're coming back in for behavioral health, but that they have a follow-up appointment in 3 weeks and it will be with the following clinician. In addition to that, under the leadership of Secretary Sutters, there was a very comprehensive program, I'm sure you've read about it, for Community Partners for Behavioral Health, in addition to long-term care support services. And we think that it's a great plan for us to build off of the competencies that we already have in the FQHCs, in addition to using the additional infrastructure dollars that will become available through district funding, to further create community-based partnerships to strengthen and support community-based behavioral health organizations and all coming together as an integrated care team. Additionally, embedding resources and know-how around identifying and alleviating, so fulfilling again social determinants of health as one of the virtual integrated care team as a comprehensive way to try to address both mental health and issues around substance use disorders.
Okay. Yeah, I would agree. This is a neglected and extremely important area. I think just about any chronic disease, the presence of a behavioral health comorbidity may double or triple total medical expense. To the extent that more and more of us are taking on total risk, we need to address these things. As I mentioned before, we have embedded behavioral health providers in about 20 of our primary care practices, about a dozen of our specialty practices to address these sorts of issues. We've also developed behavioral health resource teams, since a lot of the inpatients on our medical units have behavioral health comorbidities. As you said, the importance of the partnerships here is critical. So we're involved in a number of the opioid task forces in various communities and partnering with the Behavioral Health Network really to extend beyond the hospital and clinic boundaries right into the more lifestyle modifications.
Karen, you want to? I'm sorry, somebody else? Please hold on.
Just very briefly, our focus is on prospectively identifying patients before they wind up in an emergency room. To that extent, we've just instituted a survey process, which is voluntary on the part of patients, which would help us to identify those patients. We have a fairly large behavioral health program now. We've changed the way we intake patients so that we can give them acute triage, which is a problem. People show up in an emergency room if they can't get access in near-term access. I would also suggest that telemedicine reimbursement payment policies could have an impact here as well. Patients shouldn't have to pay a copay for that telemedicine visit. It just encourages them to show up in the emergency rooms if we can waive those. The other thing I would add is that we are going to much more extensively use our clinical pharmacists for pain management and behavioral health medication prescription management, because there's a shortage of providers that can actually refill scripts. But we think, based on work
I think we've already heard about the comorbidity issue and some of the other solutions, and we know that ER boarding and special issues for children and adolescents are quite acute now. Having said that, we're doing a lot in this area, and there's a couple numbers I wanted to share with you. One is that our provider network in Massachusetts has 11,000 providers, including psychiatrists, child psychiatrists, psychologists, licensed alcohol and drug counselors. 91% of our spending on mental health services is in network. So, you know, we hear and read about those cases out of network, but there's 90% is in network. We've done some other things. We now pay psychiatrists for what are so-called evaluation and management codes, as if they were seeing a medical doctor or specialist, and that increases the rates that they can charge. We've expanded our network by, in 2015, adding licensed drug and alcohol counselors, by in 2016, adding applied behavioral analysis for autism spectrum disorder. in 2017 having a specialized opioid treatment program. And in all our value-based contracts, we expect our physician practices to take behavioral health as part of the overall care, which should encourage integration. And then finally, at our own, we're one of the plans that doesn't carve out behavioral health treatment. And so we do that ourselves within the plan. We have psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers working alongside our physicians and nurses, case managers to make sure that we integrate. So we're modeling the same kind of expectations and behavior that we have of the delivery system.
If I could just ask a clarification. In the pre-filed testimony from providers and payers, and I think this is up on the chart over to your right, 91% of payers currently offer reimbursement for telemedicine, and 81% offer reimbursement for telepsychiatry. If this is not correct, then that would be important for us to know. But since the lack of reimbursement for telemedicine continues to come up as a barrier that needs to be surmounted, this is not congruent with our data.
What I would say is that most of the telemedicine that's reimbursed is at a national level with Teladoc and American Well and companies of that sort. We're not currently, to the best of my knowledge, being paid for. We are internally funding our telemedicine initiatives, consult initiatives, what I refer to as changing reimbursement policies. That's what I'm referring to. Behavioral health, I believe, does get paid through that telemedicine initiative as a single exception. My argument there would be to waive the copay for the patient to encourage their use.
Wendy, we also, we do cover it now for telemedicine and behavioral health. That was a fairly new change, maybe a couple of months ago with behavioral health, no copayment on behavioral health. And the other piece, we recently rolled out Doctor on Demand for all of our members nationwide. But I think more importantly is those clinical care systems here in our own home state who wish to do it, if that's also an option. They have to have the right technology in place and the right protections and all that, but it's not an exclusionary practice that our local docs can't do.
Another thing we're targeting adoption is that Medicare is not reimbursing.
Thank you very much. So if I heard you correctly, Andrew, you said the best way to address costs is how we pay for healthcare. But it seems to me that it's also how we pay for health, or how we how we deliver healthcare and how we achieve health, right, in our population. So, and I think that you were talking a lot in terms of incentives. We talked about tier plans on neural networks, and we didn't talk so much about quality metrics, but that's another incentive that you put in. I guess my I'm interested to understand how can we get at the bigger picture, including breaking down the silos between the medical piece and the other parts. We've mentioned social determinants a lot and behavioral health. I mean, when I talk about health, I mean, I include the mental health and even oral health. But how can we, and I'm interested in Christina specifically because I think you are developing an ACO that is paid through Medicaid. So you're already getting less money than most people. And yet you're dealing with a patient population that's very complex and has a lot of social determinants. So how do you see the system working in a way that the payments help, but what other things do you need to put in place to improve health, which ultimately will reduce costs?
Right, and since these are our FQHCs, sort of have-nots that we're used to that level, for better or worse, are used to that level of reimbursement in part of the business model. And like what you were saying about kind of, and what I say about not over-medicalizing everything all the time, right, and thinking about it from health. Now, my perspective today is FQHCs, right, Medicaid and underserved populations. So when I think about what you're saying, and I think about how do we stop over-medicalizing things and start thinking about health, really think about what people's lives look like. So what that mother's life might have looked like by the time she's a 25-year-old child, and what that child experience is on a day-to-day basis. what the trauma might be in those lives and how you can build a trauma approach to health and care into a model of care. So that over time, while you are concurrently treating illness that exists, you are on a longitudinal basis trying to decrease the amount of morbidity that develops for people who are living in poverty, whose parents might live in poverty. So it's strategic, it's ambitious, it's a long-term strategy. But I really believe with the way the state has put together this program and the district funding that is available to make the infrastructure investments in the health centers, and let's say we go from spending 5 cents on the dollar to 12 cents on the dollar, in addition to the district investment, really talking about meaningful workforce development, bringing cadres of new people inside the exam room, but more importantly, in the community, going into people's lives, working in schools, working in the Department of Children and Families, and these types of initiatives, which, again, you really have to get out of your health care medicalization hat and start to think about things in a much longitudinal, wider, deeper perspective, and really try to get at health care costs over time and improve health and wellness, and we like to say happiness.
Carol, I completely agree with you. And at the biggest picture, and if we look across the state budget, to the extent that healthcare is consuming a greater share of the state budget, we're being forced to disinvest in health itself, whether it's public health or housing or local communities. So we certainly agree with you that. So two thoughts on that. One is that I do think that over time, and I think Christine laid this out, as we target our incentives and target our quality measures increasingly to measures of population health, then that will require the physician practices to expand it in just the way Christine talked about and think more broadly about it. I'd also like to say that our charitable foundation at Blue Cross has made social determinants of health one of its top two or three priorities, and it is doing some very interesting and innovative work with the community, looking at connections between housing and health, looking at connections between other social determinants of health, looking at the kind of groundbreaking work that's been done down at Yale and here, and looking at comparisons between Western European spending on health and healthcare versus our own kind of spending. And so it's not going to be short-term solutions, but we understand, we're concerned about it, and we're trying to develop answers.
All right, Secretary, you.
Hi, Eric, how are you?
Good, how are you?
My question's directed to you, but Andrew, if you have something to add, I'm curious your experience. I read that you have had over 60,000 online price inquiries. I assume through the Now I Know website, but Now I Know as well. Have you been able to quantify any cost savings associated with this or change of behavior associated with these inquiries?
Yeah, I'd like to say yes. This is phase one of bringing greater transparency to not only patients, but also to the clinicians. It's just as valuable as a referred clinician. And what we are doing in phase one is bringing a tool out there that we're trying to make as easy to use and trying to increase awareness and start creating a social change of thinking about and using this tool. Across the United States, the uptake of the use of transparency tools is fairly low. Harvard Pilgrim Healthcare Institute, Department of Population Medicine at Harvard Medical School conducted a study on this specifically and measured the impact of various incentives, payments, reminders, and the like, and it created a slight uptick, and it came down to low levels, below 5%. We're currently working on phase two, Secretary, and part of phase two is to get at your question and to get at a proxy of what the decision might have been had the tool not been used. We do offer a program called Save-On. It's a play on Groupon. And Save-On is what I call an active transparency tool. And what it is it's your patients, our members, are given access to a nurse who will give cost information to the member. And the active part about this is, and I think this is important for our culture today anyway, is that nurse will then say to the member, would you like us to call your physician and change the referral? Would you like us to help set up an appointment at this MRI facility? That we have found to be the greatest barrier for consumer change. It's not one to rock the boat with the referring doctor. And we can measure the volume on their volume of savings. I don't have those handy.
I agree with Eric. I want